Good afternoon, everybody. Hope you can hear me well. If you can't, raise your hand in chat or something like that and say you're talking a load of rubbish. All of a sudden, 47 hands go up in chat saying you're talking a load of rubbish. I need to make an apology to you all, and that is due to some diary clashes for myself this afternoon. So although I'm here and I'm going to do some introductions for you across the next few minutes, I've actually got to duck out reasonably quickly. And although, you know, I've been alive and in this country for over half a century, apparently I can't work out the difference between Greenwich Mean Time and British Summer Time. So I've been sat on this webinar since 2:30. I'm kidding, but it did come to light earlier today that some of us had got the times wrong in our diaries, and that has just caused a whole heap of knock-on effect that's going to be a bit of a pain for me this afternoon. So huge apologies to everybody. I will start. I will do the introductions, and I will let you carry on without me. So I'm going to disappear, and I apologize for that. Obviously, those of you that know me will get in touch if you need to get in touch anyway. I will tell you that from MS Distribution, we do have Tom, one of our account managers, sat in the meeting. I actually can't see him in the list, but I hope he's here. So Tom Dearsley, it will sit and listen and understand everything that's going on. So if you've got any questions, feel free to fire something to him, sales@msdist.co.uk. He will be sat waiting for any of your queries at the back end of the webinar. So look, without further ado, I'll actually introduce you to the guys that are here to help us today. Maybe before I do that, I'll just explain why I think this is quite exciting in the marketplace. I have been and will continue to be an exponent of actually running radios within regulation, but because we ought to do that and we ought not be naughty people. I apologize to any of our listeners and viewers in Ireland. I understand you do something completely different. Miro will tell you all about that. I'm not allowed to. I stick strictly to what Ofcom and Comreg say about the world. And so the really interesting thing about this technology that RF Elements have developed over a number of years is exactly what you're going to learn about in the beam efficiency. If you can turn the power down and still get good data throughputs, then that's a really good thing anywhere in the world, I can tell you. So I'm a huge exponent of this technology. I hope that what you'll hear today will be something that's really interesting and pique some interest for you. So on the call, we have Miro, who is UK Ireland representative for RF Elements. But more importantly, we have Thomas with us. Thomas is one of the headline RFE guys who understand this stuff inside out. So please do feel free to ask him all the challenging questions you can in the world. And if he can't answer them, well, nobody in the world can answer them, probably. If we don't know the answers to something, you know, leave it with us as a challenge. I promise we will come back to you and answer your questions. So please do feel free to fire questions in as we get through the presentation. I will be here sitting around for a little while before I have to jump off for my next meeting. But Miro's with us. Thomas is here to run the webinar for us. Thomas, over to you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Ian, for this introduction. And I don't know, should I say, was it a little bit overstatement in terms of like being able to answer everything and anything, but I'll definitely try my best. So, and again, welcome. I would like to welcome all of the attendees from UK to this webinar on behalf of RF Elements. I am Tomasz Wolenski, and I'm a product manager and marketing manager with RF Elements. And today we'll tell you why beam efficiency is the most important antenna parameter in WISP networks, at least when it comes to the unlicensed band, which is of course very much utilized. So let's jump right to the topic. So antennas have many so-called textbook parameters, and being a WISP, well, the question is, do you need to know about each and every one of them? And the answer is, of course, not. So in the WISP industry, there are only a few antenna parameters that you should really know and care about. Now, in general, it's fair to say that many of the antenna parameters are connected to one another, sometimes in a complex way. The textbook parameters are usually thought of to express the ability of antenna to deal with the interference are front-to-back ratio, side lobe levels, or ETSI masks. Now, these you most likely know or at least heard about. So the one that we at RF Elements believe is the most important in terms of noise suppression is beam efficiency. Beam efficiency is the ratio of the energy contained in the main lobe to the total energy an antenna radiates. Now, in other words, it tells you what part of the radiated energy is going into the main lobe. Yeah. So the higher the beam efficiency is, the more energy is in the main lobe, in which, in other words, is where we want it to be, and less everywhere else, which in other words means in the side lobes. Since side lobes do a lot of harm in the unlicensed networks, beam efficiency of antennas you use is something that is really worth knowing about. And not only that, actually, not only to know about, but also include it into your decision-making as a factor when thinking about how to deal with interference issues you might have. So to give you a practical example, here you see the radiation pattern of a generic parabolic dish antenna. So if its beam efficiency is 40%, now this means that the 40% of the power the antenna radiates goes into the main lobe. How about the remaining 60% then? Well, naturally, the remaining 60% goes everywhere else. And since everything outside the main lobe is a side lobe, it goes into the side lobes. Note that all the side lobes are highlighted in the drawing, and it's not just the fancy graphics, it's actually how the beam efficiency is really calculated. It includes all the side lobes of an antenna. So if you want to compare two antennas in terms of side lobe performance or noise rejection, if you will, beam efficiency makes it extremely simple. So the higher number wins. It's as simple as that. In this example, the ultra horn on the left has beam efficiency of 99%. So only 1% of the power it radiates is in the side lobes. So on the other hand, the generic dish antenna has beam efficiency of 40%. So the remaining 60% of the energy is in the side lobes. So clearly 99% is more than 40%, which is why ultra horn is better antenna in terms of noise suppression and probably the best on the market. To be fair though, let's have a look at the parameters you might already know. So front-to-back ratio is one of them, and many antenna manufacturers include it in their antenna data sheets. So let's have a small recap of front-to-back ratio. The conventional thinking about front-to-back ratio is that if it's high, it means that antenna is good for dense collocation. So if the antennas are back-to-back and both have high front-to-back ratio, they will not interfere with each other. The reality is that front-to-back ratio does not mean that antenna is good for dense collocation in every possible setting. It's simply a misconception. It is important to understand this because the next time you may have a conversation about front-to-back ratio, you can be sure that if anyone tells you that high front-to-back ratio means an antenna is good for dense collocation, you know that the person is either misinformed or simply didn't go deep enough with the topic. High front-to-back ratio means that the back lobe is small. Now, this is the lobe pointing in the opposite direction as the main lobe. Now, it can also mean that the group of side lobes around the back lobe is small, depending on the definition or the way the front-to-back ratio was determined in the first place. So front to back ratio is easy to understand. I mean, looking at the radiation pattern of an antenna, in this example, we show the pattern of a directional patch array. The front to back ratio is the difference between the gain of the main lobe and the back lobe, which is pointing backwards. In practice, the front to back ratio is often determined based on the strongest side lobe from a plus minus 30 degree solid angle around the back lobe. And that's just because of possible manufacturing, assembly, or material imperfections. Now, because of these imperfections, the back lobe might not just be a single lobe pointing backwards, but it can be divided and fractured into several minor lobes around it, and thus this extended definition, which is used obviously mainly in practice when we actually want to come to an experimental value of the front to back ratio. Nevertheless, back lobe is one of many side lobes antennas used in WISP industry usually have. So if back lobe is one out of many side lobes, then it's probably not so important. Now, this is the typical error in interpretation of front to back ratio. It doesn't say anything about the other side lobes antenna may have. When two antennas are exactly back to back, which is a rare kind of scenario, so here the high front to back ratio can help to decrease the interference levels the radios might see. But as said before, a typical antenna used in WISP industry has plenty of side lobes, and the back lobe itself can be quite complex. So as soon as there are first more antennas on the same tower, or more links at the same time, obviously, or the collocated antennas are not exactly back to back, you're looking at potential issues because of all the other side lobes. High front to back ratio provides absolutely no protection in high noise environments. So for urban and suburban areas with other wireless links in the neighborhood or even on the same tower, the front to back ratio is simply irrelevant. Now, these other links may be yours or your competitors. I mean, either way, the pool of the hardware you can choose from in the WISP industry is limited, so you're most likely using similar hardware, and which means that their antennas most likely also have many side lobes that create the noise that is received through the rest of the side lobes. Another parameter I wanna mention briefly is side lobe level. So in practical life, its value is similar to that of the front to back ratio. So let's have a look at more details here. Side lobe level is the difference between the gain of the strongest side lobe and the main lobe. Now, as such, it is a little bit more useful than the front to back ratio because it at least points out the strongest side lobe, which says about antenna performance, and it has some information value in the high noise areas. If side lobe level is high, so the strongest side lobe is close to having the gain of the main lobe, well, that makes a very poor antenna for WISP networks. The issue with the side lobe level is that it doesn't talk about all the side lobes. So side lobe level is defined by the strongest side lobe, which again, it is only one side lobe out of many and defined at a single frequency on top of that. Now, since the side lobes are usually changing with frequency, the noise level also changes with them. So despite you know what the strongest side lobe is at a single frequency, it's in the end not very useful in the bigger picture, since simply by switching the channel, everything simply changes. Now, side lobe level is therefore similar metric to front to back ratio. It tells you what the strongest side lobe is at one frequency, but nothing about the rest of the side lobes throughout the useful bandwidth of an antenna, which is the biggest issue with these metrics. In WISP networks, all side lobes matter, not just one. To sum it up, not all the antenna parameters are practically useful for WISP networks. It depends on the context an antenna is used in. And in the end, it is up to the users and actually mainly the manufacturers to responsibly look at each antenna parameter and evaluate whether it is useful in the framework of WISP networks or not. So the conclusion for the front-to-back ratio and side lobe level clearly says that these two are not so important. They tell a very limited part of the story of the side lobes. And if you're wondering why WISP antenna manufacturers use them, well, my guess would be that it's basically a remnant of the times when these parameters were the only ones that were easy to determine, without enough computational power, which is clearly completely different today when the computational power is very cheap and abundant. You may also heard of the ETSI masks, now, which to a degree also serve as a parameter that says how well antennas perform in terms of noise. So let's have a closer look at the ETSI masks. It's important to clarify that the ETSI masks consider two principal cuts of the antenna radiation pattern. So the azimuth and elevation. Yeah. So these masks consider two slices of the whole 3D radiation pattern. So again, rather incomplete measure from the point of view of the whole radiation pattern and all the side lobes that matter in WISP metrics. ETSI masks are observed at three frequency points. So the beginning, middle, and at the end of the spectrum an antenna works in. Nevertheless, the rest of the spectrum, which is rather wide in the case of the WISP networks, is not included in the ETSI definition. So how does one get to the actual ETSI masks themselves, and how do they look like? Starting with the polar plot you may know from the antenna data sheet, and kind of redrawing it on an XY plot, the ETSI mask is the blue dashed line, which says that the radiation pattern should stay below the mask so that an antenna can be declared compliant with a given ETSI norm. So this mask is changing with angle, which results into it having a few steps visible from the plot. Now, if the radiation pattern doesn't stay below the mask at any of the frequency points at which it is defined, the antenna is not compliant, which is the case in this particular example, as you can see from the drawing at the edges, of the radiation pattern. So the masks are easy to understand, and to their credit, they do consider the whole 360 degrees of a circle, let's say that one slice, a circle of the radiation pattern, but unfortunately only two cuts of the whole 3D radiation pattern at three frequency points of the whole spectrum an antenna works in. So vast majority of the spectrum is just not included. Now, therefore, in terms of the interference suppression, they're also not so useful. So whenever you see an antenna being compliant with the ETSI norm of any number, know that it does not bring much added value in terms of suppressing the noise in WISP networks, especially the more broadband they are, the more broadband frequency band you're using. So at RF Elements, we strongly believe in doing the right thing for the customer and the industry at the same time. So we looked into the textbooks as well and found out about the beam efficiency, which is the most complete measure of side lobes out there, if it's used well. Now, when I say the most complete, I'm not just trying to push some marketing fluff through your ears, and in the following slides, I will make it clear why. So beam efficiency is the parameter WISPs should have been looking for. It it really gives the right answer to the right question about side lobes. Despite you might have never heard about beam efficiency before, we at RF Element, we do what we believe is the best for the customer, even if it means bringing on board something not considered before and which might be different from what other manufacturers say. If beam efficiency is the ratio of the energy contained in the main lobe to the total energy an antenna radiates, it is also a measure of side lobes. So we can get the percentage of the side lobes by subtracting the beam efficiency from the 100%. We can get beam efficiency of an antenna by measurement done in an anechoic chamber, like the one you can see in the image, where the antenna is attached to a rotary stage, which rotates it in two axes, and it can measure the radiation pattern of an antenna, the whole 3D radiation pattern. So based on the measurement rate of the antenna, we can calculate the beam efficiency. If the model of an antenna is precise enough, or an antenna is rather simple, we can use simulation software to do the same thing, to obtain the radiation pattern, and based on that, we can calculate the beam efficiency. So again, if beam efficiency is 40%, the 40% of the power an antenna radiates is in the main lobe. The remaining 60%, therefore, must be in the side lobes, because where else would it be if it's not in the main lobe? So note that all the side lobes are highlighted, and so that means the beam efficiency includes all the side lobes of an antenna, not just one or a slice of the radiation pattern, but the whole package, the full 3D data. Similarly with sector antennas, so here is an example of an antenna with beam efficiency of 58%. So the remaining 42% of the energy this antenna radiates is in the side lobes. Now WISPs use a wide chunk of spectrum, but in the antenna textbooks, the beam efficiency is defined at a single frequency as well, and actually for a single polarization. Now, this is the case for most textbook parameters. And again, it's up to the user and mainly the manufacturer to consider whether one should care about the whole bandwidth or just a single frequency point. Since the computational power is much more affordable nowadays than it was in the past, the choice between wideband or narrowband information is really just a matter of deciding what is important, rather than figuring out what we can do or what we're capable of doing. Today, we can easily do both, no big deal. Now in WISP industry, it makes perfect sense to average the beam efficiency over the whole bandwidth the antenna is working in, because WISPs use their antennas in a wide frequency band. So it only makes sense that an antenna should perform well in the whole bandwidth. Now therefore, we extended the textbook definition of beam efficiency to a number that is an average of beam efficiency over the whole useful bandwidth of our antennas and over both polarizations. Now this turns the textbook definition of beam efficiency in sort of a super parameter, if you will. It is much more robust and more reliable measure of the side lobe performance than the single frequency and single polarization version, or anything else that may be out there. So vast majority of antennas used for sectorial coverage in WISP networks are either patch arrays or horns. So the patch arrays have many frequency-dependent side lobes, so their beam efficiency values are around 60%, depending on the manufacturing and design quality. The RF Element's horns, both symmetrical and asymmetrical, have beam efficiency between 90 and 95%. So you can see other horns in this graph as well. This is to highlight that it takes a considerable effort to actually design a horn such that its beam efficiency is high. a stable and zero side low performance is not a given as soon as you use horn, but we put a lot of effort into optimizing our antennas to have beam efficiency of at least 90%. Similarly, the point-to-point antennas, the patch arrays are again at the bottom of the beam efficiency performance because of the many frequency-dependent side lobes that collect and transmit the noise, which hurts any and every WISP network. Now, dishes are somewhat better, and generally the bigger the dish antenna, the better the beam efficiency becomes if the antenna is carefully designed and well manufactured to make give you a complete information. Now, with any antenna though, the compromises accepted at the design stage simply cannot be compensated by the manufacturing quality, since the real world results are at best approaching the design based simulation, which really is ideal in every sense. Now, what is interesting here though is the ultra horn. So its beam efficiency is 99%. Over the whole bandwidth of operation in both polarizations, the beam efficiency of ultra horn is practically perfect. Now, only 1% of the RF signal is in its side lobes. So if you ever wondered if ultra horn is worth the extra cash compared to a dish with a similar gain, you have a very clear answer here. With 99% of beam efficiency, it's probably the best performing antenna on the market in terms of noise suppression. So the noisier the area you want to deploy it in is, the more value you get out of using ultra horn compared to a dish with similar gain. So beam efficiency tells you everything about side lobe performance. The higher it is, the better the antenna performs. As simple as that. So, you know, forget the front to back ratio, side lobe levels, or ETSI masks, and focus on the beam efficiency of an antenna when dealing with noise. Not only it is the most complete measure of side lobes, but it is also extremely robust measure of side lobes because of the averaging over the whole frequency band and both polarizations, as I explained. Now, since it rarely happens that a wireless link is situated in a completely isolated place, the interference is present almost everywhere. Now, the noisier the environment, the more important the beam efficiency of an antenna becomes, because the higher the beam efficiency, the better the noise isolation. Recently, you can also hear the claims of other antenna manufacturers saying, for example, well, this sector patch array antenna works like horn in terms of avoiding the noise, or similar statements. Now, to these claims, I would immediately ask a question: what was the beam efficiency of this antenna you're talking about? Now, if the beam efficiency is of similar values, then I would surely agree. But otherwise, if beam efficiency is anything below 90%, you can be sure that they are definitely not the same. So in the following section, I will tell you about the practical consequences of using an antenna with high beam efficiency. Now, we can sum up the effect of high beam efficiency antennas into a single statement: higher throughput. So in a sector with no other links in the area, you don't mind the side lobes really, but as the number of sectors starts to grow, their side lobes cause the noise floor to rise. And higher noise floor equals lower throughput. So the beam efficiency of patch array sectors is on the order of 60%, meaning the remaining 40% of the energy are side lobes that collect and transmit their interference to other links within yours, but also the competitors' networks. So low beam efficiency equals to lower throughput and consequentially more unsatisfied customers. So low beam efficiency of dish antennas works in a similar way. The side lobes collect the noise from its surroundings and transmit it to all the neighboring links as well. So whether it's a backhaul link or a distant narrow sector, the beam efficiency around 45% means a low throughput in high noise areas. Replacing the low beam efficiency patch array sector by a horn antenna with beam efficiency up to 99%, the noise level in the urban and high density areas is effectively avoided. Because high beam efficiency means no side lobes, and no side lobes means no interference, and the final effect of which is high throughput. Addressing the most pressing problem of WISP networks becomes a lot more easier and a lot more straightforward. Only one final advice here, really. Use antennas with high beam efficiency. High beam efficiency equals to high throughput. The radio manufacturers are also trying to do their part and help with the issue of noise. So GPS synchronization, which ensures that the radios in your network transmit and receive at the same time, protects you from self-interference, but not from the side lobes of the competitors' antennas. So high beam efficiency antenna ensures you don't have to worry about interference at all. It does not receive it, so you don't need to try to deal with it in the first place. So beam efficiency is a very practical antenna parameter, where before the discussion about the side lobes was limited to, okay, this antenna has many side lobes, this antenna has very little side lobes, or this antenna doesn't have any, or this antenna has. Beam efficiency provides a number from 0 to 100%, and it is easy to compare the side lobe performance. No more long quarrels about this one has less, this one has more. Just tell the number and everything's clear. So now you know that the front-to-back ratio or side lobe level are parameters that are not important nor useful in WISP industry, especially in the unlicensed bands, because they only consider one side lobe out of many an antenna might have. So beam efficiency includes all the side lobes, which makes it a very useful metric. Including all the side lobes, remove any ambiguity, and you can be sure that this metric is reliable. And always ask whether a parameter is single frequency or wideband, because in WISP industry, the wideband is simply a must, because the spectrum is shared by many, and now therefore the wideband performance is vital. RF element's addition to the beam efficiency definition is to average it over both polarizations in the whole antenna bandwidth. So you cannot do better than that, literally. So therefore, beam efficiency is the ultimate measure to judge antennas by in WISP industry. And it is a tool in your hands, actually, to make better decisions for yourself, for your business. So please use it and actually ask for it if an antenna you're looking at doesn't have it in its data sheet. You know, when the pressure comes from the users, the manufacturers will have to answer eventually. Right, and to make it easy for users of our antennas, we added the beam efficiency or the figures of our antennas into all our data sheets. So we are a transparent manufacturer and want to provide our customers the information that is important. And user education is also an important part of our awareness activities, and it is one of our many, you know, first in the WISP industry things that we at RF Elements can put on display. So our idea is that only an educated customer can make a qualified decision. So we're also very open about myth busting, because there are many myths and misconceptions that can create big problems to many users. So on YouTube, you can find our channel with the name Inside Wireless, which is a series of short educational videos about all kinds of things concerning the antennas in WISP industry. We also have an online community, either on the major social media, like Facebook, obviously, Twitter, but we also have rflab.com. which is our user forum where you can register and ask your questions. We announce the participation of RF elements on industry events, and also upload recordings of webinars such as this one and other videos. Of course, last but not least, you can also search through the questions already asked if you have any. And the trademark disclaimers, I don't think we used any in this webinar, so I'll just skip that. And now is time to end my monologue.